phone calls. I told him, call me. I said, I can help him get closer to God. But today now, let's look at Ephesians 2:2. We're talking about reigning over darkness. And in verse 2, it says, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. Notice that term, according to the prince of the power of the air. That's exactly what it means, just like it's written. That's the devil. He's the prince. Now notice the Bible refers to him as a prince. Because Satan used to be very close to God. The anointed cherub. I like what I heard Becky pray the other day when she was here in prayer. She said, God, you have so much mercy that after the devil sinned against you, you didn't even destroy him, but you let him keep going for a while. That was a good way to put it, you know. But we used to walk according to the prince of the power of the air, according to the course of this world, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. Now we got a lot of children here. And we are all children of God.
Amen.
But I decree that every child of anyone that goes here will be a child of obedience, not a child of disobedience. Amen? Amen. How many of you can believe that with me? For every child here. If you're a child of any parent that goes here, I believe you will no longer be a child of disobedience, but of obedience. So he says, we used to walk. How do you walk according to the prince of the power of the air? That means he's influencing you. That means the devil is having an influence on your life. See, this word walk, when it says when you walk, it means to live or to be occupied with. To be occupied with. Are you occupied with the prince of the power of the air? Is he dictating to your life what you do or what you don't do? You see, we all used to walk according to the prince of the power of the air. See, that's what it says. Wherein time past, you walked according to the course of this world. What's the course of the world? All that's in the world. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. Not of the Father, but is of the world. And then, according to the prince of the power of the air. Now, the devil, if you didn't know, Satan has a realm in what's known as the second heaven. God's kingdom is called, well, where God's kingdom is visible where you go, it's called the third heaven. That's where Paul was caught up to. He said that he was caught up to the third heaven. The second heaven, if you were to die or leave your body, so you don't have to die to go there, you could be taken in the spirit. And you would encounter a second heaven where there's buildings, there's roads, there's places to go in the spirit world. Satan has his kingdom there. He sends out demons from the second heaven that's in the air, you see? See, it's invisible to our eyes, but visible to you if you was to leave your body. Only thing blocking you from seeing that realm is your physical body. When your spirit is looking out of your eyeballs, you're only able to see in this physical world. The earth world, which is known as the first heaven, which is just the atmosphere of where the devil's kingdom comes, and then he sets up his leadership and his authority in the first heaven realm, which is just the atmosphere around us. But we only see, if we're looking through these eyeballs, God designed these eyeballs that at least right now, you can only see the earthly things, earthly people. You can't see the angels that are all gathered here. But they're here. If you was to die and leave your body, you would see the angels, mighty angels, just listening to me preach, taking note of everything going on in the service, planning what they're going to do with you. Amen? What they're going to do with me after church. Seeing who will give allegiance to the Lord Jesus or who will keep their allegiance to the prince of the power of the air. See, the devil's a prince because he rules over many people. He's the prince of the authority. Now, that word power means he's the prince over the authority or the jurisdiction of the air. He's influencing people. He's the one influencing the gangs. Anytime you hear of a shootout or gang activity, it's because there's a certain type of principality that's influencing the minds of the young people. You know, and the shooting with gang people, gang kids, I don't even think they should call it murder. Because most of it, they don't even know who they're killing. You know, they're shooting at people because they're in a different neighborhood. They don't have a personal op against them. It's a killing. But they should have a neat category for that kind of thing. When a young person kills an opposing gang member, it's not like a murder where, you know, you might have someone mad at someone in your family and you develop a plot and you murder them, you know. This is just petty warfare out there on the streets. But it's not petty, but it's illegal warfare. If you go join the army, you can kill an opposing soldier, and it's perfectly legal. You see? That's more like how the gang battles are. They're trying to copy what it's like to be in the army. You know, they should just send all the gangbangers to the army when there's a war going on. Give them some nice guns and let them go to battle against the enemy, because that's what you do in war. You see what I'm saying? But on the streets of society, it's totally illegal. That's why they gotta lock you up. They gotta rid you from society if you're acting in those type of ways. But all that influence, you know, gangbanging, drug dealing, homosexuality, adultery, fornication, you know, all the explicit sexual things that have burst on the scene through music videos, through Hollywood, through cable TV and regular TV, there are people who are walking, they're being occupied with the influence that comes from the prince of the power there. They're being influenced by another force. But the question is, who will you allow to influence you? You going to let the devil influence you? You should never let the devil influence you. I've said this many times. If you get in, you know, you might be in a discussion with your own mate, with your husband or wife, and you don't agree, the devil might start prompting you to get mad and start yelling and slam the door and different things. Because there's demons that are attracted, not only attracted to, but there's demons that are sent to destroy every marriage on the face of the earth. They lurk at the doors of every marriage and see how to get in. Spirits. See, demon spirits are very intelligent beings. The devil is the prince of the power of the air. He was the anointed cherub. His problem was he got to thinking, because he was so powerful and so beautiful, he had precious stones covering him. He could make music just out of his own being. He got to thinking that he deserves to be worshipped like Jehovah, like God the Father did. The Bible says he was perfect in wisdom. See, until he got corrupted. He retains that subtleness, that wiseness, but it's corrupted now. So do the angels. The angels are very intelligent. They study human beings. They know exactly what to do. How to get a young person going the wrong way, or how to get an old person to go the wrong way. How to get a spouse to commit adultery. And how to influence nations and governments. They've been at this a long time. God made Adam about 6,000 years ago. The devil and his kingdom was already dwelling in the earth realm at that time. So that's why when God put Adam and Eve in the garden, who showed up but Satan? Got in the serpent and began to talk to Eve. And when the devil comes to you now, he don't tell you he's the devil. He won't say, look, I'm Satan. I want to kill you. I hate you. No. Even though he hates you, he'll hide that hatred. He might come through someone, he might come through a person that you've been looking up to. Or he might come through a person of the opposite sex, you know, to try to lure you into engaging in stuff that is not lawful before God. You know, it's the devil that has been sent out to try to get young people to engage in sexual activity before they're married. But I want every young person to know here, if you wait till you get married like God set it up, it'll be much more better. Your conscience will be clear. When you do have a baby, you'll have a mom and dad right there to take care of it. You won't consider killing your baby through abortion. Because you'd be wanting a baby when you're married, you know. Even when people are not married, they'll still have the baby. But you're still not following God's perfect way. God will forgive you of all your mistakes, though. But if you know the truth, walk in the truth. If you know the light, walk in the light. It's much better.
Yes.
The sexual experience ain't even that good on a one-night stand. It takes being married to develop that whole thing. And the more you're with that one person, the more it gets better and better. And that's all I'm going to say about that. But just a one night with someone, that's not how God designed it. You end up just feeling stupid afterwards. Well, I've never done it, you know, but I... Because I was a virgin until I got married, you know. And I was happy because I got saved, like I said, when I was 16. But I heard this one evangelist. Now, she was an evangelist. She was an older lady now. She was like 50 years old. But her husband died. One of her old friends from high school or whatever contacted her. And she ended up going out with him. And then they engaged in that activity. She was in church, in the prayer line. She was supposed to be helping to pray for people. But the power of God got so strong, the devil threw her to the ground, and she ended up swarming like a snake in the ground. And then people who had discernment knew that it was the devil, and they cast a demon out of her. And then when all that ordeal was over, she confessed before the whole church. She felt so stupid. Here she was, an evangelist. And she repented before the whole church. And she told the whole story, what she did. And she said after that one time, just one time she fell. She said it was like the worst, like leading up to the moment was okay. But then right afterwards, she said she felt the worst feelings ever. She felt down in the dump. The devil that led her into the temptation now was the same one condemning her. You slimy dog, you shouldn't have did it. God's not going to forgive you now. You're not worth nothing. She fell into a world of torments. See, that's how the devil does. One demon will be sent to lure you into the temptation, just leading you on, stirring up your flesh. Having you come across across Beyonce music videos to stir your flesh up. Or Rihanna, or, you know, leading you all the way. The devil's just working. You get in the bus, and someone's playing one of them songs, and they're just stirring you up and leading you out. So then you do it. The second afterwards, the devil's like, you swine. God's not going to forgive you now. And the devil will be tormenting you so much you can't even feel God, and you feel like he will condemn you. Of course, you got to repent. But see how the devil brings all kind of confusion in the minds of people. But if you're a young person here, hold out and do what God will. People will like you better that way too. You hold out, you'll be the most desired person around. You'll draw the right kind of man your way, if you're a woman, you know. You'll draw an honorable young man your way, who don't want to get you to do something before you're married. That's the kind of man you should want. But you got to hold that standard no matter what. You know, if you're with someone, you got to hold that. If you're a young man, see, you especially got to be responsible. You don't have to act like some crazy dog that's out of control. You got to get a hold of yourself and act honorable. And you can make it clear. You say, you know what? You know, I'm getting to know you, whatever. And you say, but one thing for sure, I'm not going to go too far in any physical relationship. Maybe hold hands or something like that. Or a little kiss on the cheek when you say goodbye. But that's about it. But if you're a man and you tell a woman that, that woman's going to want you so bad, probably. She's going to want to stay with you. She's going to say, this is an honorable man. I can trust him. Honor. You know, that will turn on a woman like crazy. And then, like the Bible says now, if you're with someone, and your flesh is burning, it says it's better to marry than to burn. Go ahead and get married then, you know, if you're old enough. Better to marry than to burn if you found a nice Christian person. You know, if you're having trouble staying engaged for a long time, set up some kind of marriage date, you know. Go downtown or whatever. Or call a preacher. I could do weddings, by the way, if you need to get married. You can call me. And that's the way to do it, amen?
Amen?
But the other way is where the prince of the power of the air is influencing people. And the people do all kinds of stuff, making it seem good at first, but then their life is a mess. Their life turns into ashes. But even if your life is turning into ashes, God says, I'll take your ashes and give you beauty, amen? But don't say, you know what, I haven't messed up yet, but because God is so good, he'll just give me beauty for ashes anyway, so I might as well make a mess. No, don't make a mess. Somebody got to do it right, amen? Somebody got to hold on to the truth. Oh, if you're a young person, you can do it. I used to love saying I was a virgin to other young people when I was 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. I stayed a virgin all those years before I got married. And if the conversation came up, I gladly told them. I said, because I'm serving Jesus. They didn't know what to say about that. But some of them said, man, that is a good thing. And they're like, wow, that sounds amazing, you know, because they never thought about it. But I gladly took a stand for Jesus. I love getting in those situations to tell people. So, the thing is, the Word of God is pointing out that the prince of the power of the air is around. Now, look what it says. Among whom we all had our conversation in time past. Now, let me pull up this word conversation, because it's not what we think it is in the original Greek. It means among whom we, it means to busy oneself. It means you were busy with the devil. Busy with the prince of the power of the air and the things of this world. To live. Among whom we lived with. We behaved ourselves. See that? It's not just your talk. Have conversation. Be used. Among whom the devil used, you know, in the lust of our flesh. You see that? The prince of the power of the air works through what? The lust of our flesh. Fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. You see that? And we're by nature children of wrath, even as others. So the devil is a master, and his demons are masters at knowing how to get to people's flesh, get in their minds, get in their desires. Because it says he makes them, he works with them. We all had our conduct. We all were busy under the influence of the devil at one time. When you're under the influence of the devil, you don't even know it. Because you're in darkness. He's the king of darkness. He's the prince of darkness. I don't want to call him a king. He's the prince of darkness. So when you're in darkness, you don't see where you're going. You don't understand until the light starts breaking through. And then you begin to see. Jesus is the light. Someone say, Jesus is the light.
Jesus is the light.
You see, but in times past, we walked according to the lust of our flesh. In time past, among whom? See, among that prince of the power of the air. He works to get in your flesh. Fulfilling the desires of the mind, of the flesh and of the mind. The devil puts thoughts in your mind. Like I told that gay man, because he started wondering, he said, maybe I'm not gay. I said, no, you're not gay. I said, you just thought you were. I said, somebody must have got to you and put that thought in your head. I said, but you're not gay. He said, God made us man to like a woman. Man, I'm telling you, that guy, he's going to get saved. I know it. He already called on the Lord, right, you know, right in the van with me. But the devil gets people to fulfill or to carry out, to execute the desires of the mind and of the flesh. The devil gets people to observe the desires of the flesh and of the mind. You see that? Now, we deal with our flesh. See, even as born-again Christians, Paul said, I learned to keep my body under through fasting and through prayer. So the flesh don't get the best of me either, he said. So, it's one thing to feel or to get a fiery dart from the devil. See, the Bible says he sends fiery darts your way. He can hit you with a fiery dart and with a thought that's evil. But don't fulfill that thought. But when you're under the prince of the power of the air, look what you do. Fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. You just carry it out. Devil puts a thought in his children. Go get some blows. Or some rocks. Or some, or a 40 or a 6-pack or whatever. And you just fulfill it. You go and you get it. And you get high because the devil wants you to get high on a fake high. He don't want you to experience the Jesus high. How many of you Jesus high? I'm Jesus high.
Yes.
I wouldn't want to spoil this Jesus high with a blunt or a blow. That would spoil this high. Man, I wouldn't want that junk. I had enough of that. Since when I say I was a drug addict, I wasn't one of these casual drug addicts, you know, get a little buzz, be like, man, no, I got so wasted I forgot who I was. I'm telling you. We used to do some heavy drugs back in those days. Late 70s. I literally remember that I forgot who I was. In fact, one time I thought I was a rock on the ground. I remember that day. Oh, Lord help me. And in that state of thinking that I was a rock, the image of my mom came in the back of my mind. And I remember sitting there wondering, like, who is that person? Saying I used to get wasted on drugs, tripping. And I'm here to tell you, Jesus high blows all of that away. I'm high 24/7.
Yes.
I am high 24/7 with Jesus. And I can drive while I'm high. When you're that high now, you might even forget you're driving, but God got angels with you to drive that car. Don't even miss you. Sometimes she'd be like, is she herself swerving like that? I'm like, don't worry, the angels got me. I'm just high, don't worry. Oh man, I'm aware of them angels too. Sometimes it seems like I'm just floating down the expressway. But Jesus' high is better. But when you're under the prince of the power of the air, you're influenced by him. You become a child of wrath. You carry out the evil thoughts that the devil puts in your mind. You see, those demons, there's like, okay, you got the prince of the power of the air, which is Satan. But then the Bible says there's rulers of darkness of this world. Rulers of darkness. So there's... There's also the rulers of the darkness of this world. That are ruling and directing people that are under his control. Because they're rulers. They're leaders. They're guiding the blind. They're guiding those that are in darkness so that they all fall into a ditch. Jesus even told the Pharisees, you are blind guides. He said, the blind leading the blind, both are going to fall into a ditch. Now the devil's already doomed. He knows he's going to be ended up in the pit of fire. So he wants you to go there. Demons want you to go there. So they'll make you blind and lead you along. And blinded, see, the darkness of this world, which is the people now. The people are darkness. They're blinded because they're in darkness. They end up being led into the ditch if they stay under his control. But how many of you know that Jesus came to change that story, amen?
Amen.
Now, these powers that are working in the air, under the prince of the power of the air, you can see their influence all over. There's demon influences that actually get into the governments of nations. Any Islamic government is under direct influence from certain principalities of Islam. Because it's a religion of darkness and evil. It's a religion of opposition against Christ. Because one of their main things is that God don't have any son. And that Jesus did not die and rise again from the dead. So they have that in their doctrine so that a person can't get saved and can't know God. So the prison power of the air, they get into governments, not only Islam, but there's atheistic governments. You know, look at China. Look at how Russia used to be with the Soviet Union. When those spirits took over, they went in Russia and China and destroyed churches. Just destroyed churches and locked up preachers. They're still locking up preachers in those countries. Especially China still. But you got to see the spirit behind it. It's the prince of the power of the air that's working. See, the devil very slimingly got into the United States government in these last couple years. See, now, for example, abortion was made legal back in the early 70s, I believe. But there was not a president that was all for support of killing babies until now. You see, the presidents would always speak out against it, saying, no, I'm against abortion. Even President Clinton, he was a hypocrite, but he would say, I don't really like abortion. I wish there were few abortions, but I support the women's right to choose, you see? When you say you support the women's right to choose, what you're saying is, I support the idea that if a woman wants her baby killed, that we should kill it legally. It's all up to the mother. If she wants to get rid of that baby, we should kill the baby. Kill it. Burn it. Tear it limb from limb. Whatever you want to do, just kill it. See, that's what you're really saying, because that's what they do. But all the presidents would speak out against him. But now, the devil got it even in the White House, where the president is all for it. You know, not even saying, I'm against abortion like Clinton did. Now it's, abortion, fully support. People should be able to kill their babies if they want to. Same thing happened, but in a really bad way, with the homosexuality. These are principalities. These are demons working. It's nothing but demons working, trying to set up strongholds. Now they got the United States White House and the Supreme Court and one whole party fully supportive of the perverted homosexuality agenda, even to put it in the school's curriculum so that you can get as many gay children, turn out children as being gay as possible. But what's behind it is the spirits. It's the demons working. That's why it's very important that we continue to come against those principalities and powers. In the Wednesday evening prayer, in the prayer line you guys got, you guys need to come against those demons. And you'll see those chains begin to break. We'll see a change as we pray, because it's put in our hands to do it. Now look at John 12 and 31. John 12 and 31. Jesus said, before he went to the cross, he said, now is the judgment of this world. When did Jesus say? He said, now. That was when he was standing on earth, before he went to the cross. Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall what? The prince of this world be cast out. Because Jesus knew he was about to go to the cross. He knew he was going to rise and overcome death and overcome the devil. He already resisted the devil. But Jesus said, now shall the prince of this world be cast out. Now he shall be ejected. He shall be put out. Thrust out. But I know what someone's thinking. They're like, then why do we have to worry about him if he was put out? So that's what I'm going to explain to you. That's what I'm explaining to you. See, now, in God's mind, is a little different than what we might mean as now. Remember, in God's mind, it's only been 2 days since Jesus came to the earth and said this. 2,000 years is like 2 days ago. It's still now. Someone say it's still now. Now, Jesus said this, but look what happened in Acts 26. Sometimes I can hear that song. We've got the power. Well, it's because this is what it's talking about. Glory to God. I hear it in my spirit. Oh, God, it's good. Paul is giving his testimony. His name was Saul. This is the guy who wrote most of the New Testament. Paul, an apostle. Here is his testimony. He was talking to a king because they had arrested him. And they were wondering, why is he talking about Jesus? He said, at midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from heaven. He said, at midday, now it was noon, it was light out, but I saw a light from heaven above the brightness of the sun. All shining bright. Shining round about me and them which journeyed with me. And when we were all fallen to the earth, I heard a voice speaking unto me and saying in the Hebrew tongue, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And I said, who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus, who you persecute. But look what Jesus told him now. He said, but rise and stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of these things which you have seen, to make you a witness of this encounter, this face-to-face experience, and of those things in the which I will appear to you. See, Paul was blessed to have many visions and revelations of Jesus. So Jesus was telling him, I'm making you a witness and a minister to talk about these things that you're experiencing right now with me, and that the things that I will appear to you later. And then he said, delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles, unto whom I now send thee. He said, I'm sending you now to the Gentiles. Now, incidentally, Paul was on his way with papers in his hand from the chief priests to arrest all Christians that he could find and put them in jail. He hated Jesus, and he hated Christians, and Jesus stopped him in the middle of his craziness. And Jesus said, now, I'm sending you to the Gentiles to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power, this word power means the jurisdiction, of Satan unto God. Notice Jesus said, I'm sending you to open their eyes. I'm sending you to turn them from darkness into light. I'm sending you to take them from the authority of Satan. See, he's the prince of the power of the air. So that they turn from the power of Satan unto God. That's what happens, nonsense. But Jesus was telling a man, I'm appearing to you so that you can open their eyes.
Yes.
You know, through preaching, through prophesying. Paul, after this experience, actually became blind physically. Mm-hmm. And God sent a man, a Christian named Ananias, to go pray for him 3 days later. And then the scales fell off his eyes so he could see again. Because Paul had to be made blinded because he thought he knew what he was doing when he was killing Christians. So Jesus had to prove to him, no, you're really blind. But I'm going to use you now to make the blind see. Not only physical blind, but spiritually blind. It's worse to be spiritually blind than physically blind. He said, now you, he said, look, unto whom I now send thee to open their eyes, to turn them from darkness to light. See, it was in Paul's power. Remember what Jesus told the other apostles. He said, you go into all the world. He said, first he said, all power, all jurisdiction is given unto me now in heaven and in earth. So remember what Jesus said, and now shall the prince of this world be cast out. When Jesus rose from the dead, he rose from hell with the keys of death and hell. And Jesus was given all jurisdiction. He won the right back from the devil. How did the devil get the right to the earth? Because Adam and Eve gave him the right to rule over man. Jesus came as the second Adam. And then when he rose, he said, now all authority is given unto me in heaven and in earth. So the prince of the power of the air that's still working, they're on shaky ground. Amen.
Amen.
It's like a tenant living in an apartment when they are already received the 5-day eviction notice, glory to God. You know at any moment, the sheriff could come and cast you out of that apartment, you see? That's how the devil's working still. He's still working in the atmosphere. But he's already been served the eviction notice. The judgment has already been set that he no longer has a right to operate. But he's still doing it under that threat that at any time the sheriff could come and say, get out. And guess what? You are the sheriffs. You are the sheriffs. You're the ones that when you encounter the devil, you say, devil, you've got no rights. Especially to work in your life. Better not let the devil work in your mind and in your flesh. I don't care what it is. The devil don't got no business. He's already been judged and he's been cast out. Now all you got to do is take that power from Jesus. That's why the Bible says, the devil as a roaring lion walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Says, whom resists steadfastly in the faith. And then James said, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Because
yes.
He knows he ain't got no business being there in the first place. He got no rights over you. He got no right to make you do stuff that he wants you to do. So when the devil comes trying to mess with you, trying to get you to do stuff he wants you to do, resist him. Say, devil, you ain't got no rights. I'm giving you no place. Jesus won the right to this earth back, and I follow Jesus. Yes. That devil will get out so fast before he gets burned. Yes. Before he gets burned alive. He knows he's on illegal territory. It's illegal. But you have to enforce it because you are a human still.
Yes.
Jesus appeared to Paul, a man, and said, now you need to turn your eyes, open their eyes, and turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God. That's the gospel. We need to tell people, hey, Jesus came to set you free.
Amen.
You dealing with alcoholism? Jesus came. The devil got no right to grab your body and mind with alcoholism. So all you got to do is say, devil, get out of this person, and that bondage will break. Smoking. Devil, you've got no rights. I break you up there. Spirit of nicotine, I break you. Spirit of drug addiction, you've got no rights. Glory to God. You are a sheriff that has to go around evicting the devil. That's why Jesus said, these signs will follow those that believe in my name. They shall cast out demons. And we'll close with this, Ephesians 3 and 9. And Paul, this is Paul writing this now. He said, and now, this would be interesting. Look at this. Paul's writing this. He says, whereof I was made a minister. According to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his mighty power, or of his power. You see? He said, and to make all men see. Now, see, I didn't even know that part was in there. He said, to make all men see. What did Jesus say? I'm calling you to open your eyes. See, now, I didn't even put that together until now with this verse. He said, and I was made a minister, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. Now, look at this. To the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by what? By the church, the manifold wisdom of God.
Yes.
See, Jesus won the victory, but he's given the power to the church to deal, to manifest power against the principalities and powers. You see, those principalities and powers, when Jesus rose from the dead, all power is given unto Jesus, they just continued to work like they always did. And they will continue to work in governments, in atmospheres, in cities, in schools, through music videos, through Hollywood, through churches, through false preachers and false churches, until someone who knows the power that Jesus gave the church to cast him out and to deal with the devil. You got the right to deal with the devil to get him out of your house. You got the right to deal with the devil and don't let him in your life. See, because now to the intent, or for this purpose, that now unto the principalities and powers in the heavenly places, talking about spiritual beings, that they will get the message through you that they need to go. Because they're going to get the message of the manifold wisdom of God. In other words, they thought, after a while, They probably thought what Jesus did, well, okay, we're still working, we're still killing babies, we're still making people stupid. See, but time is going on, devils are still working, the devil's kingdom is still getting stronger. Certainly got stronger in the United States through the gay marriage thing. That strengthened the devil's kingdom. That's why I'm so upset about it. You're going to hear me keep talking about it until we tear that principality down. It doesn't belong here. A man should not be thinking he's a woman and then liking another man. It's ridiculous. Put me on the radio. Put me on TV. I'm going to tell it, glory to God.
Yeah.
I'm going to get in the airwaves and tell it. Amen. Pray to God put us on the air somewhere. Over radio, TV, I don't care. Mm-hmm. I'm going to tell it like it is. I'm going to tell it nicely. But I'm going to just tell it. If you're a man, you're a man. God made a woman. Hello? Are you smarter than a 5-year-old? Are you smarter than a 2-year-old? Are you smarter than a dog even? Most dogs know better. Most male dogs are going to go to a female dog. Sometimes they might get it mixed up, but you just got to correct them. See, but they'll get the message quicker than some of these people that are under the prince of the power of the air. You see? Yeah. There's none but influence of demons that got them. And see, what happens is when someone gives allegiance to the devil, evil spirits possess that person. That's why you see a similar feminine spirit get into men. Then they really start acting like a woman and trying to talk like a woman. I've had plenty of them in my Uber car. And they all talk with the same kind of pronunciation and real proper. And it's a similar spirit that gets in them. And the demons actually possess them. But there's more to deal with than just this homosexuality spirit. How many of you ready to let God use you to manifest the manifold wisdom that He's releasing in the earth? Amen. Look at them young people saying, God, use me. I want all the young people to say, God, use me.
God, use me.
Work through me.
Work
me. I'm yours, Jesus. I belong to you.
I
don't belong to the devil.
I will follow Jesus
all of my days. Now clap your hands for the young people. Now let's all make this confession right here. Young, and a little less young, all together right now. Say, Father God, I thank you for your word. I understand our position in the earth as you gave us. To take back the territory from the devil, because he has been cast out. He's been evicted. And he just has to be served notice and be cast out. Use me, God.
Use my life.
Fill my life with your goodness. I submit to your goodness. I submit to your ways. I give my life fully to you, God, through your Son Jesus Christ, because he is the victor who conquered hell, conquered death, and destroyed the devil. And I thank you, God, for this purpose. The Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil, and to destroy him who had the power of death. I take this power. I take the rights you've given me. Jesus didn't die in vain for me. I take my rightful place to tread over serpents, to tread over scorpions, and upon all the powers of the enemy. And I am sure Nothing will by any means hurt me.
Use me as a
light. Even to baffle the devils. The principalities and powers. Use me with your wisdom. To show unto the principalities and powers. That your plan is coming to pass. That Jesus is Lord. Well, let's clap our hands for God. Thank you, God.